I think it is the greatest action movie of all time because it works on every conceivable level. It's a great action movie. It's got a great story. The simple genius of taking the antagonist of the first film and making him the protagonist of the second film. What a wonderful idea. So simple and so fabulous. I don't think I ever received the blessing, but I went down to see James Cameron and I asked for his blessing. Yeah. He said, I can't give you my blessing. I don't know if you're going to do a good job or a bad job. I said, fair enough. I don't know if you're going to do a good job or a bad job on Avatar. And we both sort of laughed, and he told me the story of how he felt following Ridley Scott after Alien, where people didn't believe in him. Yeah. And they thought, who's Jim Cameron? He's done Piranha 2, and he's trying to follow Ridley Scott. But he knew he could honor the mythology and tell the story in a new way and hopefully make everybody feel respected and satisfied. I think it's safe to say we all like Aliens very much.
Yeah. I knew it was coming. But this is not the future my mother warned me about. And in this future, I don't know if we can win this war. This is John Connor.
I was always fascinated with the future war, and it looks so difficult and scary and so hard to stay alive. And for me, reminiscent of what Europe went through during World War II, and I was always fascinated by that level of difficulty. And I've never experienced that level of difficulty growing up in suburban California. And it fascinated me. And that's the only reason why I thought this film was a story worth telling, was because it was all about the future war. I didn't want to make another contemporary film with a Terminator coming back in time and chasing either John Connor or Kyle Reese. And I thought it would be much more appropriate to explore that world and see the becoming of John Connor the hero, see the becoming of Kyle Reese, and then introduce a new language of machines that were all in the interest of getting to the T-800. Yeah. The most proficient killing machine. I just wanted it to be a credible, real world where I looked at Chernobyl and I talked to futurists about what would happen in the face of a nuclear event. What would the sky temperature be like? And what would happen to the patina of the Earth? And in studying that, I tried to reflect that in the creation of a new film stock and the way we process the film, which is adding 3 times more silver than you traditionally add to a color film stock. And it gave it a patina and a feeling that was very original and slightly off. And of course, that off feeling is the bombs have gone off and the world is different now. And I hope it's more engaging because of it. And it's a very scary choice because it's not the blockbuster colorful choice. It's a little bit more of an artistic choice that I hope people appreciate.
Something has changed. Those hands have been busy.
If you saved us once in another future, you can save us in this one.
I killed my mother. You killed my father.
If we stay the course, we are dead! We are all dead!
You will not kill me.
We spent a great deal of time discussing it. You would have to wait 3 to 5 years for the radiation to clear before you could exit the mountain. So he exits the mountain, he comes out and he says, I'm John Connor, I know how this happened. Listen to me, and I will lead us all to victory. And imagine if he saw someone from the French army or someone from the American Marine Corps. They'd say, why would I listen to you? Get in line. I've been doing this for 20 years. You listen to me, kid. And he'd have to earn his way every step of the way. And that's where we meet him in our movie. He's just a very highly regarded soldier, but a garden variety soldier. He's by no means the leader. And through belief in his own conviction, he comes to be the leader of the resistance. So it's that dark period between Judgment Day and 2029 that we explore in this film. It's never been explored, and it felt like a worthwhile point of entry.